egész nap azon aggódtam. Sose vagyok lámpalázas, de egész nap az voltam, mert ez lenne az első magyar nyelvű eladásom a karrierem történetében. But the previous speaker gave me an excellent excuse to do it in English. So I will do it in English. I hope nobody minds. I see every day and all day actually that people are writing emails and answering WhatsApp messages and Vibers. They don't have really time to pay attention to the talks. So for these people, I move the conclusions in front. So this is the summary, the take-home message. Compo is becoming robo and Mako is becoming evil. So now you can write your emails again. For those who have time to pay attention and who want to pay attention, let me recall the dark periods of artificial intelligence, AI, which is called the AI winter. In the 90s and the early 2000s, people got disappointed because those intelligence machines just were not coming. We call it the AI winter, and the good news is, by now, the winter is over, summer is coming. This AI summer, and it's very close already, we are somewhere in late May, I guess, the AI summer is also coming with a paradigm shift. And the shift is in the type of intelligent machines we want to build. In the 20th century, the big dream was to build thinking machines, and the iconic challenge that was driving research was to build a computer by the year 2000 that could beat the human world champion of chess. And pretty sure, 3 years before the deadline, IBM's Deep Blue won, and Kasparov lost. In the 21st century, the big dream is to build acting machines. And the corresponding grand challenge is to build a team of robots by the year 2050 that will beat the world champion of football. We are going from digital intelligence to embodied intelligence. And this also means that the very notion of intelligence is being widened. In the old 20th century version, intelligence had a narrow meaning. It was only limited to the mind. Whereas, as we all know, behavior, also intelligent behavior, depends on three factors: the environment, the body, and the mind. And the new 21st century's version takes the body and the mind into account and wants to build intelligence in the broad sense. There are lots of ways to go after intelligence. My way has a research motto, which can be accessed by two sentences. The first sentence reads, evolution can create intelligence. This is a fact. We know this. You and me are part of the evidence. And the second sentence is a simple extension. Artificial evolution can create artificial intelligence. This is not known for a fact, but this is a very plausible working hypothesis. And this is how I want to go for AI, evolve it. So this brings us to the notion of artificial evolution. Is there such thing as artificial evolution? And the answer is yes. It's not that new. It's 30 years already, maybe. There are books about it, many books. Of course, to you, I can only offer the best, so I offer one book here. And this book and any other book would tell you that evolution comes down to two basic mechanisms, reproduction and selection. Selection as in natural selection, the survival of the fittest. And there are even people who argue that there is no such thing as artificial evolution. Evolution is evolution, only the substrate is different. It's not wetware, but software. So we could have about evolution, and that's it. If evolution is used as a problem-solving technology, then there are good arguments for using it, and I mention here three. Evolutionary problem solvers can solve problems that are really hard for traditional engineering and optimization approaches. Evolution is also about adaptation. So if the circumstances change, evolution can cope with those changes and keep optimizing and adjust the solutions. And last but not least, evolution can come up with very creative, original solutions that is hard to conceive for human engineers who are limited by the laws they always followed for making designs. If you want to apply this for robots, then and a robot football playing team, then the first question is, okay, how would they look like? What is the optimal body type for playing football? And once you know the optimal body type, what is the optimal control mechanism? If you know the body, how is the brain? You can answer this question in completely different ways. You could fantasize that having 4 feet is better than having 2 feet for playing football. And if you start with that, you will build very cute dog-like animals that can play very cute football. Or you could be an anthropo-chauvinist and say, no, football is football as we know it, and a robot has to have 2 legs, a torso, and 2 arms, and a head, and forward directed eyes. Or you could be very, very open-minded and say, okay, football doesn't even need feet. I could have wheeled robots as long as they can kick the ball into the goal. And some would say this is the end of football without feet, but you could go for it. So how could you design good bodies and good minds to it in a way that you don't separate them? The answer is, you won't be surprised, evolution. So the big question that I want to answer is, can robots evolve? And if you recall the definition of evolution, it needs 2 things. It needs reproduction and selection. And selection is the easy part, because you know, if you want to evolve robots for some purpose, then you can judge them by that purpose, and you can postulate that a robot that scores many goals will have many offspring, a lot of children. So selection is not that hard. And therefore, this question boils down to, can robots reproduce? Or, in common parlance, can robots have children? If we could do this, it would be a big breakthrough. And there is a simple way to do that, actually. So the easy part is, evolve robots, but only limited to their brains. If we can fix the bodies, and then the brain is just software. And we know how to recombine software, how to cross over and mutate software. That's what evolutionary computing is about. My group is participating in a Horizon 2020 project, and we are working on exactly that for 1.5 years. And you could look at it as robots are teaching robots through telepathy. They are sending over their whole brains, and the recipient just crosses over its own brain with the foreign brain, and the whole group is getting smarter and smarter at a very nice pace. If we really go to the body, then we need a completely different mindset. We need to have robots that can reproduce and that can create new robots. So I was thinking about it for a while, and in 2011, I was invited to tell about these ideas on a TED Talk. And the TED Talk series, if you have never heard about it, it's a series that wants to have crazy ideas, you know, far-reaching ideas. So that was really a forum for me to use. 2 years later, a bunch of roboticists and me wrote an article, published a system design, which also helps in implementing it. It identifies 3 components of an evolution robot system, and if you want to build one, you just have to make them one by one. Then I started to write EU research proposals, asking for a lot of money to do that, and they were all rejected, saying it's impossible. It's a fantastic project. It's a fantastic project. No money. And in 2015, my own department gave me a small amount of money and said, okay, go ahead, make a pilot, show it's possible. So make a proof of concept. Make the breakthrough. Now, if this breakthrough could happen, then it would mean something about the substrate where evolution takes place. So good old evolution, as we are part of, takes place in vitro, in vivo. In the 20th century, this was converted into software. It takes place in silico, and the area is called evolutionary computing. If we could make this breakthrough, then in the 21st century, we could bring the whole thing in hardware that would work in material. And the name that we coined for this is the evolution of things. My colleague and friend Jim Smith and me published about this in Nature last year. And for us, it's quite a confirmation that the ideas are really solid. To show and demonstrate that this technology would very far-reaching impacts also on other scientists, let me quote a preeminent evolutionary biologist, John Maynard Smith, who said in 1992, "So far, we have been able to study only one evolving system, and we cannot wait for interstellar flight to provide us with a second. If we want to discover generalizations about evolving systems, we have to look at artificial ones." Here is the design. Let's go down to Earth, stop fantasizing, start building. So this is a system design with the three major components, which we call, does it have a laser pointer? No, okay. No laser pointer, so look at the picture and find the red pyrite. That is the birth clinic. So the very idea is that there is a genetic language which specifies a robot. And this is not a crazy idea, actually. Each and every human-made object, like this thing or this thing, had a building plan. It existed on a drawing table first, even this thing.
Or my shoes. That is the DNA that you can change digitally in a computer. You can mutate it, you can cross over it. And once you have a building plan, you have only to convert it to a physical object. Convert a genotype into a phenotype. That's what happens in the birth brain. Once the conversion is finished, you will get a robot, the baby robot, which has to learn to use its own body. It has to learn the hand-eye coordination, because the body will be probably completely new, it has never existed before, too many legs or too long limbs. It has to learn to walk, identify objects, distinguish food from other robots. After successfully finishing this period, there's an exam. And if they pass this exam, they are declared fertile. Then, and only after that, they can conceive children on a robot. This prevents the best of reproduces. And when a grown-up robot is released into the arena, that's where they do what they have to do. That's where they do their work, they live, and they produce. It's very important that we definitely do not want to have pregnant robots. We do not want to have robots that lay eggs, because it would mean a distributed reproduction system. And you only want a centralized reproduction system. So the birth clinic is for the robots, a single point of failure. For us, it's a kill switch. If you want to stop the process, you can simply shut down the birth clinic and then we won't have to use anymore. Evolution will stop. So the Robot Baby project had one single objective, build an evil sphere in the simplest possible form. And the simplest possible form is make two robots, make sure that they learn what they have to learn, have them, you know, meet and mate, and produce a child. We oversimplified everything. First, he said, okay, let's make the 3D printer be the birth clinic, the uterus, if you will. And then we also realized that there are no 3D printers at the moment that could print complete robots. You could print components, but you cannot print electronics, and there are limitations to printing moving parts. So we have a kind of hybrid system. Some of the parts are 3D printed, and some of the parts are re-engineered, like, you know, the servo motors and Raspberry Pis. And we have a robot genetic language. A genome is an expression that specifies a robot. And we created two expressions, which were two pieces of DNA. We built the robots, the green one and the blue one on the picture. These were the parents. And then they underwent a training procedure with an overhead camera watching them and giving them feedback. It gave them brownie points, or it gave them big minuses, so as to screen up to learn something. And that was very, very simple. All they had to learn is to walk and approach a corner, which we declared to be the mating corner. Once they met there, they started to communicate with each other, discussing whether they wanted to have a child. And this was the point where they could have a baby using those traits. They can only have a child if they are good enough in what we want them to do. And obviously, we didn't have any conditions in it. There were two robots, so they had to say yes to each other. They did. And after that, mating was really virtual. They sent the genetic code by Wi-Fi to the 3D printer. They started to print the components, and then the student, you know, engineered by hand and assembled the robot. That was the moment when the first robot baby on Earth was born. This was in April, or in February, I guess, and in May we presented this on a huge international tech festival. And if you want to have more information about it, you can go to www.evosphere.eu. We will have a video where you can have some additional information. If this technology really took up, then there were different flavors possible. For instance, you could distinguish
flavors by the presence of the human in the loop. We could have the human in the loop, which would amount to breeding. For thousands of years, we are already tweaking around with evolution, and we influence the course of evolution by selecting the parents. You know, the cow is the most milk, the sheep is the best, you know, all that. We could do that for robots too. So we could build breeding farms with robots, and we could, on this breeding farm, develop robots for environments for which we cannot design robots. For instance, for forests. Forest environment is very challenging for robots. You can imagine there could be small ones and sneaky ones or very big ones. They could have wheels or legs or flying. Everything is possible, and breeding them in a real forest environment seems to be a good idea. If the technology worked without humans, we could send them to another planet and have them form, you know, habitable planets for us. There's another possible application, even though a little bit far-fetched, so we could combine the Internet of Things with the evolution of things. So imagine the future of the 3D printer. It could be something like a personal replicator. And I'm thinking of a huge thing like a huge American refrigerator that could make you stuff. You ask for new sunglasses, it gives you new sunglasses. You ask it for a new pair of shoes, it makes you a new pair of shoes or a t-shirt or whatever, scissors if you need. And then these are objects you can have from your replicator. If you like them, you use them. Otherwise, you recycle them immediately. And if you use them and like them for 2 months, you will recycle them after 2 months. Clearly, these will be networked. A huge worldwide network of these things will communicate with each other. And once again, like every object, these things will have building plans, the DNA, that can be crossed over. So a Japanese pair of shoes could cross-fertilize with an Italian pair of shoes, and that will be my next pair of shoes. Or I could mutate a French pair of shoes and have a new pair of shoes for myself. And this means that crossover and mutation reproduction will be given in the system, and rather than the survival of the fittest, we would have the survival of the coolest. I wrote about this in Dutch, I'm really sorry about it, in a book called Het Beste Idee from 2014. If you really want to read it, it's just 2 pages, and Google Translator could probably help you a lot with that. Opportunities. So this is a business conference, and I'm the crazy scientist. I looked into the opportunities, and I guess within 5 years, it's a very sure bet, you will have robots that evolve their brains in fixed bodies. The technology is already there. Lots of possible applications could, you know, fuel the development. In 5 to 15 years, with given enough money, so if there are any millionaires in the room, I'm eager to talk to you, we could build the first evosphere, robot building farms, that could be used to, you know, evolve robot foresters or robot pets, and especially soft robots. Soft robotics is hot. Is the next big thing in robotics, and there is absolutely no way to design those things because we don't have the theory for it. We know mechanics, we know electronics, but we don't know the soft stuff. So evolution seems to be perhaps the best, perhaps the only option to really design those things. And even longer term, 15 years or more, these things could be autonomous, and we could send robot colonies for, you know, do terraforming on other planets or ultra-deep mining, seafloor mining, in environments where we cannot go, we don't want to go. And once we are talking about lots of different robots, we could also use them for entertainment. And we could build, not the Jurassic Park, but the robotic park, and make sure that they behave better than those dinosaurs. So where is this all going to? I don't really have a good answer to this, so I have to make an analogy or a comparison. And I can't help thinking about the analogy between the big dream of building a machine that can fly, flying machines, and a big dream of building machines that can self-reproduce. And when Leonardo and other guys started to do this, they made designs that were buggy and crappy, and they killed people during the development. And certainly they didn't have a clear application area. They were not thinking in application areas, but sure enough, 500 years later, we have a whole airline industry without which I wouldn't be here. So we are at the stage of the very early designs. This Evosphere, the robot baby project, is crappy, it's buggy, but it shows the principle. And it will go somewhere. In hundreds of years, maybe in 100 years, it will lead us to somewhere which is be exciting, which is, as for me at the moment, unimaginable. But I know one sure. There will be lots of very different robots. Thank you.